Welcome, everybody, to the time of worship here at Trinity United Methodist. I'm Reverend Linda Price, and I am just so glad that we are together today, not only here, but all of our friends at home. We have, many people here may not realize that we have a large group of people watching from home, and not just this morning, but all during the week. And I am so glad that each of you has come to worship us at whatever time it is, whatever day that you are here. I know some of the people, I know Curtis there, and Francie, and Barbara, and Bud, and so I know some of the people have told me you're out there watching. If you're watching, I'd love you to let us know. You can write on the chat, say, this is Tom Smith, and I'm here, or something like that. And you can do it anytime you're watching, not just on Sunday morning. Anytime you're watching, you can let us know that you're there. I'd love to know that you're there. And so we're grateful for our friends at home. And an apology that last week we had a glitch in our online, but we're so glad that you're here today. So today we are gathering and just celebrating God. And we're celebrating many of the ministries of this church. One of the things that we celebrate is joint coming together. And so one of the things, like, if you are interested in joining the church, I will be meeting with people today at 2:00 if you have any interest in doing that. Or if you're interested online, we'll talk about how to do that. Just get in touch with me. But that will be today at 2:00. We're also starting a new small group. It's called Ping Pong Fun, and it is fun on Thursday nights at 6:30 up in the youth area. It's a lot of fun, so come and swing a ping pong paddle and have some great conversation. It's a lot of fun. You don't have to be good. I was there. You don't have to be good. And then our community food drive is this Saturday, so clean out your pantry a little bit, see what you have that you can offer. But I am so glad that we are all together, and let us open our hearts and call the Holy Spirit to speak to us during this time of worship.
Thank you.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we ask that you come today. You come today and hang out with us here at Trinity. Let our hearts become overcome with you, overcome with your love and your grace. And guide us as we go through this week, and let any person that we meet recognize there's something different about us, because we are visible by the Holy Spirit, and we are filled with your love and your grace and your power. And yes, that is your prayer for each of us this week. Someone will see you in us, and the way we walk, and the way we talk, and the way we present ourselves to other people, we can just be your hands, your feet, your ears, your mouth to someone this week. Lord, we love you. We need you so much. I'm so grateful you're here this morning. I can feel you. I know what it feels like to be overcome with you. I have felt it not all the time. But once you felt it, you want it. You need it. We ask that you continue to love each and every one of us as your Father. You be with us as we go through our work. We love you, Lord. Amen.
Mercy on earth,
We do call on the Spirit to hear our prayers. Hear our prayers for the concerns of the world. I have a particular concern that I would like us to pray for this week. I've been talking to people in the medical field. I was talking to another woman this week who has been in the hospital for non-COVID related. I know we have people struggling with COVID now. And what I'm hearing is people so tired. In the medical field, they are worn out, exhausted. And one of them said, I'm trying to be empathetic, but I'm losing my empathy for people here because almost all of them in the hospital are not vaccinated. And so I'm praying for all of us this week to pray for our medical brothers and sisters, praying for those that are in the front line, that are working 16-hour shifts, exhausted. And even more than that, losing a little bit of that passion that's brought them to the medical field. Let's keep them in our hearts this week. Pray with me. Oh, gracious God, you've given each of us a passion for serving you, a conviction. And when we lose that passion, Lord, it gets harder and harder. We feel the tiredness instead of the joy. Many of us have gone through that in our lives. But today we pray especially for those in the medical field, those treating COVID patients whose hospitals are now full again, who are exhausted and who are frustrated. Replace that frustration with compassion and give them their drive, their purpose, and why they answered the call to serve you to the medical field. We pray, Lord, for people who are ill from COVID. We pray for healing. We pray for awareness of how we can take care of each other. Lord, we pray for people going through the struggles of life, of other illnesses that just drain us. We pray for caregivers. Oh Lord, they give so much for the person they love. Feed them, strengthen them, hold them. Lord, we pray for people struggling with stress of living, grief of loss, lack of hope. You are our hope giver, Lord. Bring our conviction, our passion, our purpose back to you. May we serve you with excitement and joy in everything we do. We thank you, Lord, for the way you pull us close even when we don't deserve it, when you forgive us. Lord, you forgive us so many times over and over when we hurt others, turn our backs on you. You call us to be compassionate to others, to live grace, acceptance, and love of all people. even those we don't like. The hard, Lord, oh my gosh, it was so hard. Fulfill us, Holy Spirit. Give us conviction of purpose. Give us strength to go forward. Give us hope of you in our hearts that we can share with others. And it is with that hope that we join our voices together everywhere to pray the prayer you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us, O Lord, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive others. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, and your glory forever.
The way that you're the miracle worker, the promised people, and you're my kindness.
You are here, moving on me, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are living, living for the promised people. Light in the darkness, my God, there you see you are.
Never stop working. Never stop working. Never stop working. Never stop working.
Would you pray for me as I pray for you? Come, Holy Spirit. Fill the heart of your faithful everywhere. Open our heart and our minds to hear the particular message that you have for each of us today. And I pray, Lord, that the words I say are not my own, but are yours. What does it mean to live a courageous faith? What does it mean for you to live a courageous faith? What does that look like? We're spending a few weeks together exploring what that can look like for each one of us. Last week, we talked about courage that we find through our faith in the Holy Spirit. And again, I apologize for our at-home friends who could not be with us. But we talked about how the Holy Spirit gives us courage. Courage to live the faith that we're called to live. How the Holy Spirit directs us, sustains us, encourages us. Now, we take that to the next step. And we want to look at how our courage comes from conviction. Our courage comes from conviction. Now, I define conviction as sort of a passion of knowing what it is that we're to do. A sense of conviction of whose we are. Who calls us to live a life of faith? Conviction is that anchor that keeps us firm, holds us steady. We're looking at various stories in Luke to explore this idea of courage in our faith, of how we live a brave faith. And today, our story comes from Luke 13. And this story is a little personal to me because it talks about a woman who is bent over. Bottom line is she has what I have, scoliosis. Many of you have asked me why I limp. Well, I don't limp because I have bad hip or bad knees. I limp because I have scoliosis, curvature of the spine. And it throws me out of alignment. He says, then it affects my knees when I hit. But here we have in this story a woman also who's suffering from scoliosis. Starting at the 10th verse. On a Sabbath, Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues, and a woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and could not straighten up at all. When Jesus saw her, he called her forward, and he said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." Then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. Indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, the synagogue leader said to the people, "There are 6 days for work, so come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath." The Lord answered him, "You hypocrites, don't each of you on the Sabbath untie your ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her?" When he said this, all his opponents were humiliated. But the people were delighted with all the wonderful things that he was doing. So here we have a woman that has come to the synagogue on the Sabbath. Jesus is there as his practice, teaching and reading, looking at Scripture. And when we hear that they're reading Scripture, just a reminder is that they are reading the Torah, the Old Testament, not the Scripture that we're reading. They're reading the Old Testament. The Torah gives rules for what you're to do and not to do on the Sabbath day. And one of those rules is that you are not to do any work. And healing is considered work. Healing is considered work. But Jesus healed. Jesus healed. He healed. And then the leaders challenged him. And he challenged them back. "You hypocrites! What is it that you do to take care of your ox and your donkeys? You take care of them, you untie the rope and lead them to water and food. And untie the bonds of Satan." He's like, "I am doing God's work." Here in the synagogue, there is this subtle play on power. Leaders versus Jesus. That struggle that begins. And yet through it, what did the woman do after Jesus healed her? She praised God. And then we also heard the people, I think they probably were a little cautious at first watching the challenge, but when they saw Jesus and went up the leader, they were delighted to see this woman that they knew healed. Life and the work of Jesus. Jesus' conviction of what he was doing, that conviction gave him courage to challenge the leaders. So how do we find our conviction of courage? A couple things we can look at. First, we have to learn. We have to learn. It's what you're doing now here in worship. Or maybe being in a group study with other people. You're learning about Jesus, about the teachings, learning what it means to be a follower of Christ. We learn, and we listen. And when we are learning, we begin to wrestle with what we're learning. Because I don't know about you, have you figured out that when we learn stuff about Jesus, it makes things harder? Or it doesn't just, it's not just real nice and easy and black and white of what you do. We have to wrestle with what we're learning and wrestle with how we're going to live it and wrestle with what it means for us in our life. Because it doesn't always make sense. Following Jesus doesn't always make sense. Let me just say that. And so we have to learn about Jesus. We have to wrestle with it, understand, listen to the Holy Spirit of what it means to live a life of conviction and to draw our courage from that conviction. It means that we have fears and doubts, and that is okay. Fear and doubt go with our faith. But it's something that we continue to wrestle with and struggle with to get past it. When fear and doubt stops us, then that courage dwindles. So we have to wrestle with it and understand it and listen to the leading of the Holy Spirit. We have to ask God to show us, help us to learn, to see what it is around us that we're to know and to understand. It's a process. So first we learn, and then we look. We learn, and then we look. And I'm not just talking about around us, definitely that part, but we also look inside ourselves. We have to look at what is going on in us that may be stopping us from the possibilities that God is placing in front of us. We look at the opportunities as well. We look for our purpose. Don't you want to have purpose? I don't know about you, but I really envy those people that I see that just have this clear-cut passion to work in a certain area. Maybe it's with the handicap or even sports or, you know, whatever it is, music. There's a passion to serve God. It is a clear calling in their life. See the courage that they gain from that to go out and do things that would be scary, maybe for me or others watching it, but it's that conviction. The conviction as they look around them to know where it is and what needs to be done. We look, all of us need to look for our purpose. It's our conviction and see those possibilities. Tim Dearborn talked about a woman in his church. Her name was Grace. And for 40 years, she had had a ministry to the homeless there in Seattle. She went out daily and just had a heart and a conviction that these were children of God. And she would serve them and love on them. Well, somebody asked her what her secret was for longevity and just having that heart and those eyes that saw these as God's people. When other people saw the homeless as throwaways. And she said, if you want to have a ministry, and I want to say her words right, if you want to have a ministry on the street, then walk slowly and it will happen. If you want to have a ministry on the street, then walk slowly, and it will happen. You'll see it. If you don't want to have a mystery, if you want to avoid it, then walk fast. We spend a lot of time in our lives walking fast, don't we? Avoiding seeing opportunities, avoiding getting tagged by a passion maybe that we have. Because it's scary sometimes. It's scary. But it's that conviction and that passion that drives us forward and gives us the courage to take steps. And whatever those opportunities and possibilities are, God places in front of us. And then we have to act. And I'm going to modify that. It's not just act. We have to have righteous action. Righteous action. The difference of that is really important. Now, righteousness, that's a church word. And a lot of times we roll our eyes at some of those big church words. What in the world is righteousness? Okay. Righteousness is that conviction that we are aligned with God's purpose, that we understand it and we believe in it. We believe in Jesus. And Jesus here in the world and the difference that Jesus makes in life. It is our righteous anger, our righteous action that calls us to do something when we see something that's out of alignment. Think about your car. You take your car in to get aligned, right? When your car is out of line, what happens? You feel it when you're driving, don't you? Start to feel those bumps a little bit, it's not as smooth, things aren't going as well. When we are out of alignment, we know it. And when we are aligned with God, we have that conviction of the purpose that Jesus has and that calls us to have, the ride is much smoother. Doesn't mean we don't hit potholes and difficulties, but we get through them much easier. And that's the goal for all of us, is to be in line with Christ and the calling that Christ has for us individually, for this church, to be in alignment and a conviction of that purpose and call in our lives. Here, has called to break that bondage of sin like he did for this woman. Do you remember? He called her a daughter of Abraham. A daughter of Abraham. And there's a part of Jesus that wanted to heal her, but there was also this drive that he knew he wanted to do more. He wanted to heal all of God's people, to break that bondage of the Israelite people. To break our bondage as well. So in understanding righteous action, we need to understand righteous anger. Because sometimes the two get mixed up. Because we take anger action because we're angry. But it's very important. Righteous anger is this conviction that we want to change something. But we are changing something that is affecting those outside of ourselves. When we're angry, it is about us. That something has affected us, has impinged on us, is bothering us. We hear a lot of the language, you can tell just plain anger, because people talk about themselves. They talk about how they've been hurt, the things that are reasons why this action is bad, according to them. But righteous anger is about other people. We see Jesus having righteous anger. when we see, he sees injustice, when he sees things that are hurting other people. It's that righteous anger that is about others and seeing the conviction of God at work in people's lives. And people's lives who are ignored, who are invisible, are suffering injustice, and nobody's doing anything. There's a difference. Do you feel it between righteous anger and just plain anger? We can be angry at things that happen, but when we see somebody being hurt, you feel an extra energy in that anger. Jesus calls us to righteous anger, to work, to make a difference, to bring the world back in alignment, to make a difference. Jesus was angry that the woman in the temple was being treated less than the ox and the donkeys and the livestock. That the Torah can be bent for them, but not for a woman of God. Righteousness, realigning, putting things back together. God's ways at work spur us on to action. We're called to listen, to understand, and then to take action. The faith that we live is not one where we just talk the talk, but we have to walk the walk. You've heard that phrase. We don't just talk the talk, but with conviction, we're called to walk the walk. Jesus doesn't just want us to say yes to all the things that we believe, and yes, that Jesus is the Savior. Yeah, that's great. Jesus wants us to have the courage to live into that faith. To live into that faith. To be active in a visible way to make a difference. Now, it's really easy to go with the flow. When you're around all the church people, it's really easy, isn't it, to pray and to be a church person and follow Jesus. It's not so easy when we're the minority. And we as Christians need to get used to the fact we've been spoiled that we're the majority. And that is changing rapidly. We are the minority. We've just passed the 50%. The nuns are stronger. And now it means that it's not going to be so easy to live our faith. We can't just go with the flow anymore because the flow is going a different direction. We've got to live our faith. Live our faith with conviction. So what is it about your life? Where can you point to a time that you're living a courageous faith? Where are you living in your life where people can see your faith and you are righteous and you're angry that something needs to change in the name of Jesus? You've wrestled with it, you've thought about it, you've studied, and you feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit to take action. How are you in alignment with God right now? Are you out of line? Or do you feel like you're aligned with that righteousness? Righteous conviction. It gives us direction and it gives us purpose. But most of all, it gives us hope. Let's pray. Gracious God, to come before you seeking to be in alignment with you. We can see parts of our lives that are out of whack. Help us to really draw back to you, to learn, look at where you are around us, and to take that righteous action, knowing that you will give us the courage. Walk with us. You will give us that courage to make a difference, all in your name. Amen.